Why can some people eat chocolate and ice cream and stay thin?
Why do we feel afraid sometimes?
Why do stars explode?
Does everyone see the colors the same way?
Why does the ocean smell like the ocean?
Why do we cry?
Why is there a rainbow after the rain?
Why don't birds get electrocuted when they land on an electric wire?
Why do chameleons change color?
Why do we dream?
Are men really from Mars and women from Venus?
Why is the body symmetrical?
Can trees talk to each other?
Why do we fall in love?
Why is the sky blue?
Why do we sometimes see the moon in the daytime?
Great questions, Europe. These are exactly the questions that are at the core of our research here at the Weizmann Institute of Science. Curiosity-driven questions. Such questions drive our research forward. And you know, when you do research, asking the right question is already 80% of your way to success. You ask the right question, you know where you want to go, you don't know where the trail would lead you. So if you're still curious and you want to know the answer to these questions, stay tuned to the end of the session and you'll learn the answers.
Good evening, everyone. I am pleased to welcome Professor Alon Chen, President of the Weizmann Institute of Science, as well as Weizmann Institute friends and supporters, and ladies and gentlemen. I am thrilled to open the annual gala of the European Committee for the Weizmann Institute of Science. Tonight, we are celebrating the 60th anniversary of the establishment of the European Committee. It is a great honor and a pleasure to welcome all of you at this very special milestone. Of course, it would be better to meet in person, and I look forward to returning to more normal days. The European Committee's journey began in Switzerland 60 years ago when a group of visionaries came together, joined by a commitment to science and to ensuring that Israel would rise to the top of world science, even though the country was in its youth at that time, in 1960. These special individuals and pioneers made it their mission to stand alongside the Weizmann Institute's management to advance the philosophy of conducting science for the benefit of humanity. Like the Institute itself, I was also a young boy back then. However, I heard a lot about the quality of the curiosity-driven research that was taking place on the Weizmann Institute's campus. I grew up in a family who shared a tremendous passion and respect for the Weizmann Institute and its scientists. My family identified the Institute as the jewel in the crown of the State of Israel. They saw the Weizmann Institute as a gift born and made in Israel for the benefit of the entire world. During my first visit to the Institute, I was astounded by the beautiful campus and the awe-inspiring atmosphere. There, I was severely infected by the bug without a cure, the love for science, innovation, and fundamental research. Since then, I have repeatedly witnessed the excitement that new and returning visitors feel when they set foot on campus. They experience its wonders through meeting scientists in their labs, walking on the evergreen campus, seeing the Weizmann House, and understanding the historical origins, and slowly but surely becoming part of the global Weizmann family. Today, as chairman of EQUIS and its 13 societies, I look back with great pride at our collective accomplishments, which we have achieved together throughout Europe in order to advance basic research at its best. We should take pride in the hundreds of millions of euros in generous philanthropic gifts that have been raised across Europe for scientific projects, labs, buildings, institutes, state-of-the-art equipment, new scientist startup packages, and much more. But while this is all necessary and important, our top priority remains the ongoing friend-raising process of expanding our great European network with friends who are passionate about science and what it can do for mankind. Despite our cultural and language differences, all of us share one important common value, namely to help the Weizmann Institute of Science in order to advance humanity. In philanthropy and in basic research, it's all about the people. As the European Committee turns 60 years old, it is also an opportunity to think about the road ahead. The Weizmann Institute's flagship projects in the fields of brain and neural science, artificial intelligence, and physics, and all its other very essential research are a roadmap of challenges and opportunities. I am confident that together, as we have already demonstrated over the last six decades, these challenges will be met and translated into substantial philanthropic support that will allow the research to flourish. As we reflect on 2020, I was delighted to witness a wide variety of Weizmann digital gatherings featuring our scientists who showcased their exciting fields. As we all know, 2020 was indeed a difficult year. The world is facing a pandemic which has changed our daily lives as individuals and communities. The entire world is looking to science with great hope, and vaccines and drugs against COVID-19 will solve this problem. Additionally, as you may know, we had to postpone the global gathering to June 2022. I pray that by then the world will heal and we will be able to celebrate so that we can meet in person and not through screens. Every year, we choose to shed light on one of the amazing research projects underway at the Weizmann Institute. Tonight, as part of the celebration of our 60th anniversary, we would like to focus on the Institute for Brain and Neural Sciences, a major flagship project. We are fortunate to hear from Professor Alon Chen, president of the Weizmann Institute, who will talk about this project and its promise for revolutionizing neuroscience. But first, let us welcome Professor Alon Chen for a special greeting.
Dear Weizmann Institute friends, ladies and gentlemen, it is a pleasure to join you today for the annual gala of the European Committee for the Weizmann Institute of Science, which is extra special this year because we are also celebrating the 60th anniversary of the committee. I'm sure that although we are at physical distance from one another, we are together in spirit. I thought it would be most fitting to greet you from where it all started, here at the house of Dr. Chaim and Vera Weizmann. This house and its beautiful gardens have welcomed leaders from Europe and around the world. These international leaders came to acknowledge and pay respect to Dr. Chaim Weizmann as the first president of the State of Israel and founders of the Weizmann Institute, and to learn more about the institution that he built and the important scientific insight that have emerged from its labs. I'm sitting in the place where dignitaries from all over the world were hosted, here in Chaim Weizmann's library. It includes 1,200 books in six languages in which Weizmann spoke. This is a picture of the Queen of Belgium from her visit in 1959. Arturo Toscanini, the famous Italian conductor, was here in 1937. The Queen of Holland visited in 1995. These dignitaries and countless people from Europe and over the world were eager to assist and give their time and support to ensure the growth of the Weizmann Institute. There is no doubt that where we are today is the result of the vision of our friends and supporters over the years. We greatly appreciate all of you. Thanks to you and your efforts, we are able to continue the research for the benefit of humanity. Thanks to your tireless work and our ongoing friendship, the Institute continues to flourish. I want to thank everyone in the European Committee for being there for us and standing with us as we work to achieve our goals. We will meet soon, virtually, in just a few minutes, to talk about one of those goals, our flagship in neuroscience. Again, while we are separated now by many kilometers, I hope that we still are able to convey the very warm connection that exists between Europe and Rehovot. Your diversity enriches our campus in countless ways because you bring to us your precious connections, your generosity, and your unique experience and knowledge. This mosaic of people and expertise reflects the diversity that I always say drives the best science.
It's an ongoing love relationship between Europe and Israel and the Weizmann Institute.
Science is a tool for communication because at the end of the day, science, in fact, or the result of science, has no culture.
Talking about the connection between Europe and the Weizmann, the key person is Dr. Joseph Kohn.
He had contacts in Germany. He had an open door to Adenauer at the time.
These contacts paved the way to full diplomatic relations between Israel and Germany in 1965.
He understood that Europe is going to overcome the big disaster and will take a very important role economically, politically, scientifically. So that's what he did. He went to Zurich and actually laid the foundation for ECRIS of today.
I think this relationship is incredibly important from all points of view. What I mean is, on the one hand, it's very worthwhile in terms of science, the progress of science, and it's very worthwhile in terms of human contact. I mean, in the end, we are closer to Europe.
The European Committee for the Weizmann Institute has also become the link between the Weizmann Institute and something else. And that is the fact that the European Union accepted and embraced Israel as an absolutely equal member in its scientific endeavors. Israel is not a member of the EU, but it is a full member of the scientific programs of the EU. Not only a full member, but one of the most successful members. So that's an achievement of a great magnitude, both for the Weizmann Institute and the European Committee.
The European Committee was founded here in Switzerland, but the focus is not just Switzerland. Basically, it's a hub to cover the European countries.
12 countries in total. Austria, Belgium, Denmark, Germany, Greece, Hungary, Italy, Liechtenstein, the Netherlands, Spain, Sweden, and Switzerland.
I think that this is one of the strengths of ECRIS. The fact that people which comes from the north part of Europe, the east part of Europe, the west and the south, comes together with this passion for innovation and science.
6 years ago, science was very much like the art and sport, a totally international activity, but that was it. Now, science has become the leading economic assets of nations, of people, of individuals, of companies. And in that, it is very different from arts and sports. And within all of this, the European Committee grew and expanded and reached all kinds of milestones over these 60 years. Too many to mention all of them.
People are very open. They are very prone to speak to each other, to exchange minds, to exchange experiences, and especially we are all interested in sciences, in basic research work, which is done in Rehovot. So I think it is a culture of openness. We are all friends also of Israel.
People really were looking for the excellence of the Institute, and very interesting friendships were developed as a result of it.
ECRIS people are very enthusiastic about the Weizmann Institute in general, about the scientists of the Weizmann Institute, about the science that is being done at the Weizmann Institute, and they want to support it and to promote it. And I think that this all together is a wonderful combination.
People are interested to promote science for the benefit of humanity. So the connection to the original message of Chaim Weizmann is there. The
principal objective is really raising funding. An important objective also is to bring the Institute to the attention of many in European countries.
I think in the last few years we have been very much trying to create synergies between local scientific groups and the Weizmann Institute groups.
The global presence of the Institute that I think Equus has helped build over the years is one of the major contributions, because in my mind, that always comes first, and then the more material contributions can follow. But first, people have to know the name, recognize the name, feel the full stature of the Institute on the world stage. And I think that's been a big part of Equus's impact.
When you come and you present a project, it's very, very important to speak also about the scientists who are behind the project. And you could see the chemistry, you know, that was kind of built between the donor and the scientist. Amazing.
When you walk across the Weizmann Institute of Science and you look around you, you see all these amazing fingerprints of European donors, all the buildings, the institutions, the research places, the gardens, beautiful gardens.
There are gifts that you cannot really see. Those that have funded research in cancer, neurobiology, environmental science, physics.
They made a huge difference in the Weizmann, a huge difference in all studies that have to do with molecular and structural basis of life processes.
The culture of that institute is multidisciplinary, and that permeates through that excitement, the freedom of all scientists. All the people who head up our committees around the world are very familiar with that, and that's what they pursue.
Money is important, of course, for the Institute. The Institute needs money regularly, but I think it needs as much, it needs friends. We're not always out for fundraising, we're out for friend raising.
I am moved by what we as supporters have accomplished so far, but the story is not over yet, and there remains a lot to be done.
We want friends to go to the Institute, to be bitten by the bug without a cure, which means they've been bitten and they will never be cured, and they will always have the Weizmann Institute at their heart.
Make people understand what their research is all about and give maybe a glimpse and an idea where this could lead to at the end of the day, you know, what kind of new development could come out of it.
Like any other organization who is here to stay and is serving a cause which is better than the organization itself, we need to create a platform or a mechanism that will bring young people all the time into our societies of friends and will become our future lay leadership in Europe.
We have the bright and vibrant Pan-European Next Generation Club, which has proven to be a never-ending source of innovative ideas and serve to connect new friends throughout the continent.
I think what's become obvious to everyone this year is that the only thing that is going to allow us, and I say us in the widest possible sense, us humanity, to meet the challenges of the years ahead, is through science. And science is best carried out in a setting where scientists are free to pursue their curiosity-based ideas.
Sometimes it takes 10, 20, even 30 years until something comes out of it directly for the Institute, but the good thing is we have time, we are not on time pressure, which allows us to have a different approach when we approach potential donors.
I believe that the influence and the importance of Europe at Weizmann will continue.
Europe is our playground. And we are expanding east. We have a number of East Bloc countries who have joined the Equus family.
We have a duty to promote education and research in these challenging times. Indeed, we need to be mindful that governments are less and less in a position to do so. Our support of the Weizmann Institute is therefore more important than ever.
It's a great pleasure to wish all the luck in the world to the European Committee for the Weizmann Institute on its 60th birthday. For me, it's a special occasion because it's also the 60th birthday of my arrival to the Weizmann Institute, which happened at the same time. So I feel almost like a twin, and it's a wonderful occasion.
Today, the Weizmann Institute is a thriving, vibrant hub of scientific activity, a world leader in science, thanks in very large part to the ongoing support of our European friends. We literally couldn't do our research without you. Thank you for 60 years of warm and meaningful friendship.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. It is a real pleasure to send my greetings to the European Committee in honor of its 60th anniversary from Zurich, Switzerland, and where the announcement of its creation took place at the Borlaug Hotel, within walking distance from my office. The Brzezinski Center for the Interface Between Science and Humanities, headed by Professor Zachi Pilpel, gives researchers the unique chance to engage in multidisciplinary projects. It establishes a bridge between exact science, social sciences, and humanities. And it encourages both creativity and collaboration. I am happy to introduce a special dance which is an outcome of the programs within the center. Professor Eitan Gross from the Department of Biological Regulation had the idea of collaborating with the dancer and choreographer Shachar Benyamini. This was done as part of the center's program Artist and Poet in Residence. You will now see a dance named Evolve. Benyamini's choreography is performed by two dancers, Cornelia Lech and Yotam Baruch. They are dancing on the stage of the Michael Sella Auditorium on campus. The dance expresses the flexibility of human movement. It combines both gentleness and determination at the same time. Here, art and humanity almost reflect each other. Professor Ofer Feinemann from the Department of Physics of Complex Systems observed the dance. He discovered a unique reflection of his own research and will share his insight with us. I raise a toast to the European Committee and its continued promotion of science in all areas. Cheers to basic science, cheers to creativity and curiosity. L'chaim.
So this dance for me is an exploration of communication, and the communication happens in all animals, and ants are masters of communication. This is what makes them so successful, and they always lived in these huge groups, and they know how to work together, and it's all about communication. And this dance got me thinking, if communication between two people is such a miracle, what can one expect when we have thousands of ants in the dark, and all of them anonymous? Can we really expect this miracle to happen when you have communication between thousands together at the same time? It's even a greater miracle. And there can be a few answers to this. I mean, the easy answer is that ant communication is much, much more simpler than human communication. It's of course true. But I ask myself, okay, how simple does it have to be, and how complex can it be? And we don't know too much about this. We don't really understand the ant language. One thing we do understand is we can read the alphabet of the ant language. And this alphabet is so rich that actually it gives us some clues maybe that the ant language is not as simple as one might expect. And perhaps there are also miracles of communication and language in the ant colony. So I know Shachar for several years now. Since maybe 5 years ago, I participated in a course that Shachar gave here at the Weizmann, and the course brought together dancers and scientists, tried to make connections between us, and these were done by talking together, but mostly by dancing together, actually. And through the dance, we tried to explore the connections between science and art. So when I saw Shachar's dance, the feelings that came up are about the miracle of communication between two humans. And this is because the dance depicts the two dancers as such a complex, evolving, fragile, self-doubting, sophisticated beings that it's hard to believe they can even support themselves. And then the fact that the two dancers meet and they can actually support communication between them and grow together was really like a sense of miracle to me watching this dance. And then therefore I see this dance as a very optimistic one about the capacity of humans to make connections between them.
Thank you, Renee, for your meaningful and ongoing support at the interface between science and humanities at the Weizmann Institute. My thanks also goes to the wonderful artists Shachar Benyamini, Cornelia Lech, and Yotam Baruch for this inspiring and unique dance. The European Committee has had countless accomplishments over the past 60 years. Today we would like to share with you one of them, which has had tremendous impact on the careers of many Europeans who, as high school graduates, spend time in labs, on campus, as part of the Bessie Lawrence International Summer Science Institute. They have gone on to fantastic achievements. But rather than let me tell you all of this, let's hear it straight from former ISSI fellows themselves.
It was really vibrating and stimulating atmosphere.
One could feel immediately that this was an environment where the people were excited.
For me, science was very interesting and kind of a hobby to do. And during that stay, I realized that you can make that as a profession. It was a starting point for me to study natural sciences.
The ISSI is the Summer Science Institute. The participants come, they're high school graduates. Usually they come for a whole month.
It allows youngsters to come and work in the labs of scientists.
When the Europeans came here, they really made it an international program. But they added much more than that, because they made the program such a high level.
I remember that it looked really inviting, and I remember on the first evening I met many people and we started lively discussions.
We were 80 international students, all were open-minded. Everyone had a strong scientific interest.
Scientifically, it was project work. It was very closely working together with an actual scientist.
We had a supervisor who taught us a few things, and then we did experiments, and that was great to be able to do your own experiments.
What people do here is learning how to learn.
Working in a lab is very communicative because people are working on their own project, but they combine those results to one big project.
I really appreciated that people took their time to explain their projects to me, and I've done so many cool things.
They see what interdisciplinary research means. They learn to communicate. So for them, it's an orientation to science and to what science can be.
That particular program had a great influence on my decision later on. At that point, it was clear to me that I would continue as a scientist and hopefully one day come back to the Weizmann Institute and open my own lab here.
You build up an alumni that will be there for the Institute. We've been doing this for many, many years, and the people that have joined that program have come out of it feeling very loyal to the Weizmann Institute.
Every summer, one of the biggest joy for me and for my team here on campus is to meet the European delegation of the ISSI. Every year I find this group from Europe so curious, so passionate.
When they come here, it's the only place that they can be involved with the frontiers of science, because this is what is done in the laboratories here.
I think one of the strengths of the ISSI is it continues to develop all the time. It's not just cut and paste for 50 years, the very same program. ISSI develops hand in hand with science education and with science itself.
One very important point for me also was that it is extremely stimulating to talk to other people that are interested in the same field.
Having science and the social aspect in one program is very good because you get to know other people from different countries from all over the world.
It was a good balance between hard work but also plenty of time to talk, and I liked also the outings, so going to see something of the country, going to the desert.
It was always a deep wish of mine to bring friends which are not connected to Israel in our country. Now we have the opportunity to combine this wish together with getting involved into scientific projects with scientists from the Weizmann.
Giving that kind of impulse to young people to say you really can follow your interests and build up on them and have a career in science, this is just essential for all of us.
I really appreciated that they spend their money on scientific education, because I think that's a very important topic in society.
Most of my students, they said that it was the most outstanding month of my life.
I want to thank the European Committee for their commitment and their ongoing support of this program, and we look forward to continuing our collaborations.
Hello again, everyone. I'm delighted to have the opportunity to talk to you about the future of neuroscience at the Weizmann Institute. We have just talked about the role of history, specifically the historical role of the European Committee in advancing science at the Weizmann Institute. Often you hear about the history and the future being compared against one another, but they are of course tightly linked, with past knowledge providing the roots for the future progress. I like to think of science as history in the making. In science, new insights can only be gained by starting with the knowledge and insight revealed in the past by our scientific predecessors and building up from there. We merge them to the present. We look around us and reach outward to learn from the discoveries of our current colleagues within our science and outside the field altogether. And we dream about the future. Imagine what might be and how life could have less suffering and more productivity if it could solve some of the problems that afflict humanity today. Neuroscience research is often called the last great frontier of the life and medical sciences. Because there's so much yet to be explored in how the brain and neural system function and also malfunction, So many debilitating diseases and conditions are still barely understood. So many big questions, like how we learn, perceive, move, and form memories, are not fully answered. We are still imagining a better future in so many areas related to the brain. Why is the brain the hardest nut to crack? First, because the sheer quantity of neurons and the complexity of neuronal connection is unlike any network in the human body. It's so complex that it takes 20 years to fully develop a massive proportion of an average lifespan. Second, because it's incredibly difficult to study in live human subjects, but new tools and technologies in genetics, protein studies, circuitry and connectivity and imaging are now enabling us to look at the brain in ways we could only dream of before and conduct studies that we could only theorize about but never carry out until now. All of this leads us to where we are today. In neuroscience, we find ourselves at a very important moment, a tipping point at which accumulated knowledge can be leveraged to make a huge difference. Thanks to many developments, especially over the last 20 years, we now have a great diversity of expertise within neuroscience. There has been an explosion of knowledge, and as other scientific fields have developed, we are witnessing an outpouring of insights from labs that never set out to explore the brain, but whose discoveries have major relevance to it. Now the challenge is, well, getting our heads around it all. And more than that, fusing the knowledge, the metaphorical equivalent of getting everyone in the same room to talk, swap ideas, and then start speaking the same language. This is exactly why we are establishing the Institute for Brain and Neural Sciences. What do I mean by speaking the same language? Science has become so sophisticated that each subfield has its own expertise, almost like its own dialect. And because studies that originate outside of neurobiology may end up being very valuable, in fact, to brain science, we need to learn from each other and harmonize our knowledge for the sake of discovering new things. Let's examine together a few examples. Dr. Rina Rosenzweig is a structural biologist who is learning a lot about how proteins work. She recently figured out the mechanism by which two protein families break apart amyloid fibers in the brain. These are toxic fibers that have been tied to Alzheimer's, Parkinson's, and other neurodegenerative diseases. She did that work with the help of Dr. Nir London, who is an organic chemist. And then there is Professor Eran Orenstein, a molecular geneticist who is identifying genes expressed in motor neurons, and neurons that control movement. His work is relevant to ALS, a debilitating neurodegenerative disease. None of these individuals are neuroscientists by training, but they are contributing to neuroscience in dramatic ways. If brought together through the Institute for Brain and Neural Sciences, can you imagine what their research might lead to next? Let me introduce another pair. We all know that our body processes sensory information, which is something we all take for granted, as long as we remain healthy. But there are many diseases and conditions, like for instance schizophrenia, in which sensory processing goes wrong. Professor Ivo Spiegel is a neuroscientist who came from the world of molecular biology. He's discovering how the molecules and cells in our brain control its function and give us the ability to sense our environment. Professor Igor Olitsky is interested in how our DNA gives rise to RNA, which give rise to proteins. His particular expertise is a special class of RNA known as link RNAs, long non-coding RNAs. These link RNAs were once thought as part of our junk DNA. But scientists now understand they have a very important role to play in translating our genes into functions play out in the body. Igor is especially interested in how these mechanisms affect the brain. So Igor, who is in the Department of Biological Regulation, and Ivo are already collaborating. Can you imagine not having this kind of knowledge from Igor's lab brought into neuroscience? Here is another exciting example. A few months ago, Professor Ronnie Paz, who is the head of the Department of Neurobiology, identified the specific neuronal circuit responsible for eye contact as a characteristic of social skills. He also found that it is located next to the part of the brain responsible for positive and negative stimuli. That's the ancient part of the brain that helps us instinctively avoid threats or survive. The finding was evidence that eye contact and social patterns of communication evolved together with survival instincts. It's a finding that could have implications for conditions such as autism, where social function is impaired. Can you imagine bringing Ronnie together with Dr. Michal Rivlin, who is investigating the neuronal circuitry of the retina in the eye? Or with Professor Tali Kimchi, a neuroscientist who is revealing the sex differences in behavior, particularly in autism? Or with Professor Ofer Izar, whose optogenetic tools are already helping Tali and others to reveal the brain networks specific to each gender? And I could go on and on. Many of you know the Institute very well. And so you know that one of our strengths is the fact that the walls between departments and faculties are already permeable. If anyone knows how to interact informally and share ideas, it's us. It's such a good recipe for success that we have decided we need to take it to the next level. And the next level is to put interdisciplinarity on steroids. The new Institute for Brain and Neural Sciences will do exactly that. It will create the synergy within neuroscience and outside of it, both through a building whose design and layout will enable interaction, and through funding and organizational mechanisms that will encourage working across different fields toward collective goals. It will be a state-of-the-art institute that will be housed in a state-of-the-art building, and it will enable us to bring together dozens of groups across campus. This lab will include members of the Department of Neurobiology, but also many other research groups who study the brain and the nerve system across campus. This is a $200 million US dollar project. It is comprised of 11 centers on an array of research areas from mental health to perception, to memory and learning, to neurodegenerative diseases, to brain injury, and to the tools and technologies of the future. It will include the most sophisticated equipment and infrastructure because the outcomes of modern science are heavily dependent on the most cutting-edge tools. Architectural plans for the building are currently being finalized, and we hope to be able to submit them for permitting in March, with construction set to begin within 2 years. I can promise you that it will be a stunning facility. We are looking to our friends around the world to help us raise philanthropic resources that will enable the success of this ambitious project. I also think that part of our collective task is to inspire dialogue around the brain on a public scale. You can help us on both fronts, to generate what promises to be a cascade of discoveries that will help heal people and lead to a great insight about ourselves. I started out talking about history, and I will end on that note. If past is prologue, a preface to the future, I believe our European friends, who have been part of our scientific journey since the beginning, will be our partners in neuroscience discovery in the years to come. Investing in neuroscience is investing in history in the making. Thank you, and I look forward to meeting you all, our friends, in person in Zurich next year.
Thank you very much, everyone, for your participation in this wonderful event. I do hope that next year we will be able to meet in person. We decided to conclude with an ancient prayer, which is an excerpt from biblical Psalms. Although it was written many years ago, the message is still completely relevant today. I invite the wonderful singer, Einat Bezalel, for a short performance. Thank you for being with us tonight.
Shalom. I'm very honored to join you in this important event. 60th anniversary celebration of the European Committee of Weizmann Institute of Science. 60 years of Shevet Achim Gam Yachad, which means the joy of being together, allowing the Institute to continue and explore science for the benefit of mankind. I created this arrangement especially for this event, and I hope that you will enjoy it.
הנה מה טוב ומה נעים, שבת אחים גם יחד. הנה מה טוב ומה נעים, שבת אחים גם יחד.
Do chameleons change color? It's not only for blending with their surroundings. It is also the chameleon's way to transmit messages to other chameleons. In addition, the change of colors help them warm up or cool down as if they are dressed for weather.
Are men really from Mars and women from Venus? Neuroscience tells us that from the beginning of embryonic development, males and females develop different brain connections. So yes, they are.
Why don't birds get electrocuted when they land on an electric wire? Because the birds are not so good conductors, so the electricity bypasses them and continues flowing along the wire.
Why do we feel afraid sometimes? Fear makes our brain act quickly, and when one thinks quickly, one responds better to danger.
Why can some people eat chocolate and ice cream and stay thin? Changing weight is a very personal issue based on the very specific personal microbiome each individual is carrying.
Why do stars explode? Large stars, like our sun, live for billions of years. The stars are going through a constant process of creating energy. At some point when the star gets too heavy, it becomes unstable, and an explosive force sends energy back into space. We call it supernova.
Why is the sky blue? Well, all colors have light waves,
but because blue light waves are shorter, blue prevails, and that is why we see the sky blue.
Why do we sometimes see the moon in the daytime? Because the moon's surface reflects the sun's light, and it is brighter than the sky.
Why is there a rainbow after the rain? Rainbows are an optical effect. Once the light hits the water drops in the air after the rain, it is broken up, bent, and returns in the direction of our eyes.
Can trees talk to each other? Trees share resources underground using a fungal network, nicknamed the Wood Wide Web.
Why does the ocean smell like the ocean? This smell is formed out of a combination of microscopic algae named phytoplankton, plus different materials such as iodine coming from the fish and sea salt.
Why do we cry? Crying is a way to transmit messages without words. Tears and crying contain various chemical ingredients which influence those who are exposed to them.
Does everyone see the colors the same way? Probably not. One person's red might be another person's blue.
Why do we dream? Dreams help to store memories and things we have learned, including developing our creativity.
Why is the body symmetrical? Well, the body is only symmetrical from the outside. Inside, there is no symmetry.
Why do we fall in love? Oxytocin is the hormone of love responsible for our natural wish to get together and share the efforts of having the next generation.
The sun is shining.